So guys, as we have learned the various costs earlier, let's just take a recap. We saw what is total cost, we saw what is total fixed cost, and the other factor, we saw what is total variable cost. When I say total cost, I mean the total cost incurred in order to employ the inputs and use those inputs for further production. When I say total fixed cost, I mean that cost which is unaffected or which does not change, which is unaffected due to the level of output. Means irrespective of what output you produce, there is always going to be one factor or some cost which is going to remain fixed. That is TFC. Means TFC also exists even there is zero output. Even if the output level is zero, means the producer is not producing anything, even at that time there is always some fixed cost that he has to incur, meaning TFC. Then what is TVC? TVC is the cost which varies. What do you mean by varies? It means which changes with change in output. And when you add up these two costs, means total fixed cost and total variable cost, what you get is the total cost, means it is the total expenditure of the producer to produce given level of output. Got it? Means TC, total cost, is nothing but the summation or the addition of total fixed cost and total variable cost. So today we are going to see what is the role of these two costs in the short run period and the long run period, and how the producer changes his production pattern in the short run, and from short run as he moves to long run, what are the production decisions that he takes. Now here, before going into the technical part, I just want to tell you that producer, when he makes any decision, are always backed by some economic theories. So for you to understand that if you are a producer and you are going to change your pattern of production, then you have to understand certain terms, certain laws, and then you can decide whether to move from short run to long run and when to move from short run to long run. Okay, let's get started. First, we are going to learn the short run. See, the costs that we learned are also there for your numerical part, but we are going to learn the law of short run first, the law of long run, and then all together in the second section of this chapter, we will see the numericals. Okay? So, short run. As told to you yesterday, what is short run? Short run is the period in which the producer has one factor of production which is fixed and others all are variable. So here, for your remembrance, I will just write, short run is where one factor is fixed and others are variable. So what happens in short run is, the law of short run is called as the law of variable proportions. What is it called? The law of variable proportions. Why is this called the variable proportion? Because you know that one factor is going to remain fixed no matter what, but the other factors are going to change in proportion. So this law is called as the law of variable proportions. Okay. Before getting into the curve, there are three things here that we will learn. This is TP, MP, AP. Right? This P stands for product. TP is the total product. MP is the marginal product. And AP is the average product. Now these names are not new to you. As studied yesterday, product means nothing but quantity, or you can say output, right? Product is nothing but the output that a producer is producing. So total product is the quantity or output that a producer produces with the given inputs. Means whatever combination of one fixed and other variable inputs the producer is using, what is the total quantity of output that he is able to produce at given level of technology using these inputs is called as your total product, right? Marginal product. You have heard this word a number of times till now. Marginal is nothing but additional. So, additional product means the additional output produced. Marginal product means the additional output that a producer is able to produce with an extra unit of input. Right? Means whatever other variable factors are there, out of those other variable factors, if he chose to employ one more or discard one. So this is going to be the proportionate change. So marginal product is the additional product. Means definitely it is logical that being a producer, if you are employing one more factor of production, the output has to increase, otherwise it is not profitable. Right? So marginal product means the addition in your output, or you can say the additional quantity of output that the producer is getting by employing one extra unit of the variable input. And the average product, as told to you yesterday, whatever average you have to calculate, you have to divide the total by its quantity. I am saying average product. So let's take the total of this term, means the TP upon Q. So what is this Q? Q is your output or Q is your input? Tell me. Total product divided by quantity is the total product per unit of input or total product per unit of output? Obviously, total product is the output. So you will divide it by quantity of input. This shows us that how much product is produced per unit of input used. Okay, so this is the basic idea of TP, AP and MP. So now we will start with the law of variable proportions. First, I will just draw the entire law of variable proportions on a graph. Through this graphical representation only you will learn what is the law of variable proportion. Means whenever they talk about law of short run, you know that they are talking about law of variable proportions. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this is the prime figure of your law of variable proportion. As you can see, the top curve is your TP curve, means the total product curve, which is showing or which denotes the total product that a producer produces using the given inputs. Then the second curve is your marginal product curve, which increases and then it sharply declines, and then also it becomes negative. This is the negative part. And then AP. AP means the average product, which initially rises and then cuts the MP. Now, for understanding this law of variable proportion, we have to divide this entire graph into three stages. The stage one is where it starts from the origin and ends where? Up to the point where AP and MP are equal. Means this blue point here is your end of stage 1. Stage 2 starts from the end of stage 1 and ends where marginal product is 0. And stage 3 is beyond the point from where the marginal product starts becoming negative. Okay, so here I will just write stage 1 starts from the origin, ends, where does it end? It starts from the origin and ends where AP is equal to MP. Stage 2 obviously starts where the end of stage 1, and stage 2 is where ends where MP is 0, and stage 3 obviously starts where stage 2 ends and it carries on or goes on as long as MP is negative. Means you cannot tell where the stage 3 will end. Now let's start this stage wise. Now stage 1, when you see this graph, this is the stage 1. Okay, so the left side of this dotted line, that is your stage 1. What can you see in stage 1? That all the three curves are going on increasing, right? It means that this is the start point of your production. Although here the MP, the marginal product, you can see is slightly going towards the decreasing side, but it is still contributing something to the TP, means the TP is rising. Stage 1 is called as the stage of increasing returns. Okay, now let's see what happens in stage 1. In stage 1, the producer has just started the production. If he has just started the production, definitely he is going to get good market for his products. So the total product is going on rising, means he has the resources which he can use for more and more production. So the total product, the total output that he produces is going to increase. And as a result of that, obviously the additional quantity that each unit produces, each unit of input, each factor of input, whatever they produce is going to increase. So MP also increases, and when the TP is increasing, it is just a numerical and arithmetical logic that the AP will also increase, right? If I say the total product is 10, okay, if I say total product is 10 and total inputs used are 2, so my total product is how much? My average product is how much? 5. If the total product is 10 and the quantity of inputs used are 2, then it becomes 5. But what happens when I say in the same amount of inputs, my total product has now increased to 2? to well, then obviously my average product is also going to increase. It's just arithmetical calculation that TP divided by Q will give you AP. So if the value of TP is increasing, the value of AP will also increase. So this is my stage one. This is called as law of increasing returns, or you can say this is the stage of increasing returns, where all TP, AP, MP, all of these three are increasing. But when does it end? When does the stage one end for a producer? Is when the AP rises and cuts the MP curve. Now you have to understand, when the TP is rising at a good rate, means it is rising at an increasing rate here, the AP will also rise. But you know the property of marginal, as seen in marginal utility, that the marginal will always increase in the start, then decline, become zero, and then become negative. Same happens in this production. Earlier, what happens that you have, say, two units of resources. One is fixed, one is variable. And these two, using these two units of input, you are starting the production. So earlier, you will start to produce little less in order to see if it is working in the market. Then what will happen, as the product that you are producing is getting along in the market, so you will want to produce more and more. So you are going to tell those two resources only to work more to produce more output. So later what happens, when the output goes on increasing, the workers or these factors of production, they are now overburdened, so their efficiency will become less. So now they are contributing lesser and lesser towards your production. That is when the MP will start decreasing. And even after that, you don't really want to employ more production, more factors of production, but you want more output. What is going to happen is that you are going to end up with the breakdown of those factors of production. That we will see in stage 3. But here what I'm trying to explain you is that in stage 1, that is the initial stage of your production, what is happening? That the total product is increasing at a higher rate. And so the AP will also increase, but as we know the marginal product, the marginal product's attribute or the marginal product's capacity is that it will always increase at first, then diminish, become zero, and then become negative. So the additional product that we are producing here is also increasing at this point. AP is also rising, but there comes a point where AP is rising rapidly and then it will become equal to your MP. Means the additional product produced by your additional input employed is equal to your average product. Means now every input is producing the same amount of output. This is your stage 1, where all TP, AP, MP are increasing. Moving forward to stage 2. Now what happens in stage 2, you can see MP is declining. AP has cut the MP curve in the previous stage, but now AP is also declining. So when AP is declining, you have to know immediately in your subconscious that the TP might also be increasing at a diminishing rate, since the additional product produced by every amount of input is decreasing. Means the additional resources that you are hiring are not performing to their optimum capacity. Means the total product is increasing, but at a diminishing rate. What does this means practically is that there are two just factors of production which you are employing, and they are producing, let's say, 5 units each. So 5 and 5, total you are getting 10 units of outputs, right? Then what happens, your production level you have to increase, so you hire a third labor. Now this third labor is a little inefficient, he is a little, let's say, unskilled, and he is producing only 2 units. So what is happening, that in spite of hiring one more amount of input, what you are getting as the output is only 2 units as compared to the 5 units that the earlier labor gave you. So that means that the total product will definitely increase. The total product was 10 and the new worker is contributing 2. So the total product with 2 units of inputs was 10, and the 3 units of inputs, you are getting 5 plus 5 plus the new one is giving you 2. Means now you are getting total product as 12 units of output. The total product is increasing, but the efficiency of per level of input or per labor is decreasing, which means the marginal product is decreasing. The decrease of marginal product means the additional output per unit of input is decreasing. If it is decreasing, then definitely the TP also bends a little. It is still increasing, but it is on a diminishing note. See, here it is increasing very rapidly, and instead of going this straight line above, it is bending. It is increasing but at a diminishing rate. So in the second stage, you have to say that second stage is the stage of diminishing returns or decreasing returns. Okay, decreasing returns means the TP is definitely increasing but at a diminishing rate. What is the reason behind this diminishing rate increase? Is the decrease of marginal product. Means every additional input that you are employing in production is contributing less and lesser to the total output. And why is AP decreasing? Obviously because the TP is diminishing. So you have to understand one important point, that when AP starts from the origin, it is always increasing, but as soon as it cuts the MP curve, it is also decreasing, because it cuts the MP curve when AP is maximum. Now AP is maximum here, and as it crosses that stage 1, it is also declining due to declining TP or diminishing TP. Okay, moving forward to stage 3. Now here stage 2 ends when MP is 0, means now whatever additional factors you employ, they are not going to contribute anything. Now if you are a producer and if the employed units are not contributing anything, what are you going to do? Yes, you are going to stop the production. Because let's say, for example, you have 5 subjects in your curriculum and you have 5 teachers. Now if the school appoints a 6th teacher and he does not have any subject to teach, why will they employ him and pay him the salary? It is useless. Right? Same. Well, here the marginal product, the additional product from every new input that a producer tries to employ is 0. It touches the x-axis, means here it is 0. The additional input, the additional factor of production is not contributing anything to your output. At this time, it is advisable for your producer to stop the production. Means this is called as your shutdown point. This is the point where you should stop employing new production inputs. You have to stop employing the factors of production of a variable proportion, and you have to let your production be. But what if the producer does not realize? He does not realize that the additional contribution is 0, and then he starts more production. That is going to lead to the breakdown. Because what will happen? Let's continue with the same example, that the school is paying salary to the new teacher, but he is not contributing anything. Means what is happening? There is no fees coming in from a student, and there is always going to be expenditure of salary for that teacher. So what will happen? There will be a loss. Means the total product will diminish. It will decrease. Now this is a decreasing. It is falling down. Here it was increasing. As you can see, it was this, then it is increasing. Definitely it is increasing, but now here it is decreasing. Why is the total product decreasing? Means it is possible that yesterday I produced 100 units and today I am producing 90 units. When is it possible? It is possible when, instead of shutting down your production, you are employing more and more inputs. If you are employing more and more inputs and you are not producing more and more output, your cost is going to outweigh the price or the revenue that you are going to earn by selling this output in the market. So what will happen when the MP becomes negative? This is the stage where MP is negative. Means this is your inefficiency. means now you have to realize that absolutely there will be no production, there should be no production, since the marginal product is giving you a negative return, means the cost is more than whatever output you are producing. So here when the MP is negative, then the TP will also start decreasing. So this stage is called the stage of negative returns. The first stage is stage of increasing returns, where everything is increasing. TP is increasing, AP is increasing, MP is increasing. It ends where AP cuts the MP curve and both AP and MP are equal. And this end of stage 1 becomes the start of stage 2. Stage 2 is called the law of, or the stage of decreasing returns or diminishing returns, where you can see that due to decrease in MP, what is a decrease in MP? That the additional units that you are employing are not contributing anything, and hence the TP will increase at a diminishing rate. This stage 2 ends where MP is zero, and beyond that shutdown point, the MP becomes negative. Okay, this in entirety is your law of variable proportions. Okay, you have to go through this law again and again to understand how does the short run work. The short run works in variable proportion, means it is the decision of a producer how to vary the inputs according to the level of outputs. Now, if a producer wants to increase his level of output, first thing that he will do is he will tell his existing resources to work to their optimum capacity. What will they say? Work and produce more, work and produce more. But there will come a time when those resources or the labor here, they will also understand that this is beyond our capacity. The maximum that we can produce is, let's say, 200 units each. Now I am famished, my working capacity is complete. So what will the producer have to do? He will have to employ one more unit of production if he wants to further increase his output. With employing one more unit of production, what is happening? He has to check the efficiency of that labor or that unit of input. If the efficiency is less, means the additional input that you are using are producing less and lesser by the day, means the MP will decrease, hence the TP will increase definitely, but not as much as it was increasing earlier, means it is increasing at a lesser rate, means a diminishing rate. And then in the decreasing return, it ends where MP is zero, means now no matter how many new inputs you bring into your production, they are not going to contribute anything to your total product, means the capacity of your factory is done. The resources that you are employing are done. They are not going to contribute anything else. So here the producer should take a wise decision of not employing any new factor of production. But this decreasing return, why is it not ending, this negative return? This negative return is not ending because as long as the producer does not realize that his additional inputs cost is outweighing his profits, he will go on continuing. So many of the firms, they go through a decline and then they finish off the market. They are eliminated from the market because they do not take economic decisions. So see, practically also this economic subject is very essential. If you are a producer, you need not take numerical calculations, but you have to realize that yesterday I had two inputs and those two inputs were contributing 5 units each to my production, and now I have employed third unit, and instead of my output raising to 15, it is just output is raising to 12 units. It means that the additional input that I have employed is inefficient, is contributing less to my production. Okay, this is our first law. This law is called as the law of variable proportions. Now for presenting this answer, the law of variable proportion, you have to write the statement that the law of variable proportion states that the additional product that you get from hiring new or extra unit of input increases at first, then decreases, and after that it becomes negative, right? And then you have to write stage 1. You have to give the name of stage 1, that is the stage of increasing return. then explain this stage 1 in 2 or 3 statements, then you have to move to stage 2 and then stage 3 and explain each in 2 or 3 sentences. Be precise. See, in CBSE you are always required to be precise, but your answer should be brief. It is not like state board that you have to write 2 pages. You have to be very precise in your answers. Okay, so this is our first law for today, that is the law of variable proportions. Now, as the producer decides to move from short run to the long run, what will happen? In the long run, we know that in the long run, all the factors are variable. All factors are variable. Means now, the producer is well established in the market. And now he can change his requirement of input, his proportions of input as he likes. Okay, means if he wants to increase his production of one product, he can employ more inputs there. If he wants to decrease another product which he thinks is not so beneficial in the market, then what is he going to do? He is going to decrease the inputs. Now he can vary the inputs according to his needs. Means what happens? See, when you start a production, then you take the premises or the factory or the land on rent. But when you are well established in the market, you will purchase that premises. You will start the production in your own property, in your own premise, right? So then you don't even have a fixed factor of what? Rent. So long run is the stage, is that time where all the factors are variable, correct? So in the long run, whatever stage that you see, the stage is going to be, again, there are going to be 3 stages. It is this, this, and this. Here is A, B, and C. Now here the law of long run is called as returns to scale. You know what is scale? Scale is a measurement, how you measure something. So when you say this stage A, you know that this is increasing. Here it is constant and here it is decreasing. So when I say returns to factors, increasing returns to scale. When I say increasing returns to scale, it means that the amount of input that you are using to produce the output, that output is proportionally more than the amounts of input used. Like I said, every factor that you are using contributes 5. So, additional input that you used was 1, but instead of, you know, maximally contributing to 5, his skill was a little more or his capacity was a little more, and you ended up producing 6 units from that particular additional input. So, it is called as increasing returns to scale. When you talk about increasing returns to scale, the proportionate means percentage change in inputs is less and proportionate change in output, because returns is nothing but output. When you say returns, you are talking about output. So when there is a stage 1, that is the increasing returns to scale, in increasing returns to scale, always you have to understand that the returns that you have got as a result of employing inputs are more, are increasing proportionately. When you say constant, now I don't need you to explain this, you know. Constant means the amount of input that you are employing are proportionately equal to the amount of output that you are producing. Every additional unit of input employed is contributing the same, and then you are producing the constant returns to scale. And then this is a decreasing or diminishing returns to scale. Means here what is happening, that you are employing new and new inputs, but they are contributing lesser and lesser. Means the proportionate change in input is more. You are employing more inputs, but the factor that you are getting out of it, the return that you are getting out of it is less. So it is called as decreasing returns to scale. So there is no such diagram of long run returns to scale or long run law in your economics. You just have to understand these are the three basic factors of increasing returns to scale, constant returns to scale, and decreasing returns to scale. Because in long run, all the factors are variable. You can vary these three. You can be anywhere at these three points because you are now in the capacity. It is totally depending on you as a producer if you want to increase the inputs or you want to decrease the inputs. Okay? So these were the two long run and short run laws of your economics, or you can say production decisions, wherever you are in the long run or whenever you are in the short run. After understanding what is TP, AP and MP, now let's see this TP, AP and MP on a graph that we saw. If you say this is TP, this is AP and this is MP. So you have to understand, as you understood in the utility, that when MP is 0, the TP has to be maximum. This MP is 0, this TP is maximum. And here, where the AP curve touches the MP curve, it has to decrease. Okay? Means I can say that the AP curve cuts the MP curve when AP is maximum. Okay? And MP curve always becomes negative. So these are the small things that you have to understand while drawing the diagram. It may happen that sometimes you just have to draw MP curve or draw a TP curve individually. But when you take all this together to explain some graph, you have to take care of these things. You just can't go on drawing anything. Like for example, now here I drew a TP curve which goes on like this. So what happens, see, here my TP is maximum but my MP is not zero. So how is it possible that the MP is still declining but my TP is maximum? So this totally destroys the law. So while putting that law on the graph, you have to remember these key points. Okay, so that will be all for today. This is our short run and long run. From here on, we will go on understanding what are the different cost curves. As we have seen, what is TC, TFC, TVC, and all average cost curves. So these cost curves, in from the next lecture, we will plot, and then we will start with the section 2 of this chapter, that is the numerical part. Okay, thank you.